Okay. So first of all, I would like to thank the organizers for the invitation, as well as the institutions that are supporting the Biohackathon. Thanks. So I'm going to present YacMa, which is a platform that we've been developing in collaboration with a company, Bayer. And I would like to make, let's say, two points or two messages during the presentation so that you could retain. The first one is to show an example that these sort of technologies are not only interesting industry, but they could already be implemented to some extent. And on the other hand, the second point is to make you aware about the challenges and opportunities that are in the agricultural field. Okay, so I will quickly go through a motivation introduction to the topic, let's say. Then I will go into the details of the platform itself, and finally I will show a couple of results. Due to the time constraint, of course, I will not be able to review all the stuff, but during the week, of course, we can sit together and discuss and see challenges, opportunities, and stuff like that. Okay, so agriculture has changed since many decades on the way that our farmers or the people cultivating the way of working has changed a lot. Not only thanks to the molecular tools that are now available, so that they could make, let's say, extra analysis and try to take much of the data that they are gathering. But on the other hand, it's also thanks to the technologies, such as the semantic web, for instance, that are helping us to deal with the data in a different way. In this slide, you can see the type of data, or basically the diversity of data that are present in this field. You can see in the top, for instance, an image that has been taken by a drone with a special camera that is, for instance, trying to see the stress in the plants or in the fields, so that, let's say, there is, for instance, extra drought, or there is probably some certain type of stress due to some infection or something like that. On the other hand, another interesting set of data that we have to deal with is climate and environmental data. You know that farmers are heavily relying on this type of data for cultivation and at the end to get better yield, right? Other type of data, which is probably much, much common for you, is the omics data, proteomics, genomics, and all this type of data. And finally, phenotyping data. So you can there see the complexity, because we are dealing with different types of data, so it's not only the exercise of, let's say, integrating this data, but also trying to make sense of this data, as I already mentioned. Even though we are, let's say, in the agricultural domain, we are not only dealing with crops like wheat, rice, and these sort of things. We have to also deal with bacteria, with pests, with fungi, and other types of organisms. So we have to be basically dealing with all those genomes. And it's not only the exercise of getting together all these pieces of data, but also trying to make sense of it by describing and organizing in a sensible way. So the objective was, okay, we will go for this integration, and we will also try to get some tools to make sense of what our people have been gathering. How we approach this? Well, of course, it's clear that we wanted to try out new technologies and try to see whether we could get a little bit more of information by switching, for instance, from the classical relational databases. And we have done some tests with semantic web technologies. We've been doing data benchmarkings, triple source benchmarkings, and all the exercise that we've been doing in previous biohackathons too. But first of all, we've been, let's say, using ontologies. There you can see one of the dimensions that we are considering. Here we can see how we are going from the genotype world to the phenotype world. The ontologies that are highlighted in green are the ones that are available currently in our system. We are also considering to take into account the other ones. Of course, this is a classification that has been designed by us. Probably it's not fitting the needs of all the users. But in principle, it's basically what we need for our needs. So this is actually one of the dimensions. The second dimension that is helping us basically to integrate the data is how we can go from the data on this side to the workflow concept. So those are ontologies that are not specific for the life science world, that you can see, for instance, the units of measurements ontology, which can be used in other types of domains. So we've been using ontologies and semantic web with the aim of not only make understandable content for the machines, but also with the aim to create complex queries. I say complex within double quotes, because for some users, complex could mean like 30 ways of, let's say, asking how these genes, for instance, are interacting. That will be something complex for some users, but for other users will be how those genes, for instance, are interacting with this other set of genes. What are the other molecular processes that are involved? In which places of the cell are those interactions taking place, etc., etc. So we had plenty of use cases for this complex scenario, let's say. As backbone, I already mentioned that we are using the ontologies so that the user could go into this sort of cloud, something that is transparent for them, so that from there they could retrieve, let's say, the data that they want to get. This slide is summarizing the approach or the integrated approach that we developed. On the left side, on the left side we can see how we are integrating the different levels of data that I already mentioned at the beginning, such as genomic data, proteomic data, transcriptomic data. And after integrating this data through the ontologies and doing the appropriate modeling of connecting the data, we came up with a graph database. We are using Virtuoso for this in combination with some classical RDBMSs, basically Oracle in some cases. So this is the data management side that we have. And on the data analysis side, which is the side on which our data scientists are, let's say, playing a role, we also have like two worlds. The first one, in which, let's say, the expert users are making use of command line tools developed in R, for instance, or they can also go through a web interface. So that if they are, for instance, only dealing with a couple of genes, proteins, diseases, or something like that, and in case if they have like 900 genes or something like that, they could make use of other much more advanced tools. So afterwards, of course, they will get the results of their analysis, comparison of genomes and stuff like that. So how do we do this? By using REST services and APIs that we developed so that they could extract the data from the triple store. YacMa has around 600 million triples. It's relatively small compared to UniProt, for instance. There you can see the type of data that we have. We are also making use of OMA that has already been mentioned by Gesualdo about the ortology data. We currently have 33 species, and we are planning to integrate around 50 more species into the system. This is an example of the type of complex question that, as I already mentioned, like for instance, retrieve all the Arabidopsis thaliana. You know, this is a model plant in the plant world, let's say. So we want to retrieve all the proteins from this species, which are annotated with a certain activity and which correspond to a two-weed orthologs. Of course, we are not just translating this into a SparkQL directly. We are discussing with the users to what extent they want the detail of the data that is stored in the system. So then we can, let's say, not only create the SparkQL query, but also tune the data and the model so that we could retrieve what they are really expecting. And then, of course, we are going to the system itself, to the database, and we are retrieving the proteins in this case. This has been working for, let's say, typical queries for which we have developed, let's say, a pre-canned library so that the users could simply go there and click or basically adapt the name of the protein, the name of the species, and very simple things. For much more complex queries, they have to still come to us. We don't have an interface that is allowing to move forward in this direction yet. As a result, I would like to first of all summarize the platform that we built. If we start from the bottom, we can see first of all the user access. I already mentioned that we have two levels of access in the system that we believe are very important. The first one is the high level, let's say, where we have the web interface. And on this part, we have the low level, what we call low level, which is basically dedicated to the advanced users. So people with much more bioinformatics training, for instance, so that they could plug the results of a query or develop or design the queries themselves. On the next level, we have the interface, that which for the time being is through Java directly, REST services, or R. We don't have yet, as I already mentioned, a nice web interface for this yet. And on the next level, we have the storage management level, where, as I already mentioned, we are using Virtuoso. We have we implemented all the replication modules so that we could have backups and stuff like that. We are also still relying on relational databases for certain types of data, which cannot, let's say, be migrated due to the complexity or due to some, let's say, legal constraints. On top of this, we are also exploiting Elasticsearch, which has been improving a lot the performance in Virtuoso especially, so that we could retrieve much faster all the list of genes, list of proteins, diseases, and stuff like that. On the next level, the data level, it's clear that if we are dealing with Virtuoso, we have graphs and tables as we are dealing with relational databases. And finally, we have also included one more layer, which is the data stewardship level, which is basically helping us to define the standard operating procedures, how the people have to submit, for instance, new data, which type of format they have to use, etc., etc. So this is I picked up a paper, which is behind the slide, and typically our users are, let's say, identifying a set of genes of interest. Then, let's say, those are three of the usual or typical questions. I'm going to only go through the first one, in which biological processes are, for instance, all those genes involved. So thanks to the modules or thanks to the advanced way of consulting or querying the system, we can now retrieve, for instance, this type of information. There you can see the result is it's a table in which we can see the query gene, the GOA gene, the identifier, the type of evidence, which is very important in our case. We have to see what type of entries have been validated in the lab, for instance, and which ones not. There you can see the taxon ID corresponding to wheat. So there is... We added one more question. which cannot be answered yet by our system. In this type, for this question, we are trying to compare not only, let's say, the data that is in the system, but also trying to go out of the border of the species itself, so that we could compare phenotypes, for instance, between two different species or species that are related. I added this slide about the comparison of the type of work that has been done. And in the human world, let's say, so that we could apply similar strategy to do this comparative study of taking into account, let's say, different species which are related. Of course, we still need the additional data that needs to be translated and integrated into the system. Okay.